For those of you who don't know John, John really is one of the great business leaders of our time. You're currently executive chairman of L1 and broadly, I'm still active across the energy industry. Yeah, many of you will know John from his time as CEO of BP. And then, of course, he's written a number of books, and we'll touch on your latest, Make, Think, Imagine, Engineering the Future of Civilization, and we'll get to that in a moment. David, why don't we just start and give everyone a little bit of career advice. You spent most of your career at BP. You started at the very bottom of the organization and worked your way through. How did you go about building your career at BP? What were some of the lessons learned? What, you know, some advice for the people here?
Well, good afternoon. The reason I joined BP is my dear late father, told me to get a real job. I was actually doing some research at university, and he thought that was completely unacceptable, and that life is made of doing business with people. And so he said a real job. So I, since he was going to retire from BP, I went and applied to a predecessor of BP to get a job. And I took a job for a year. And because at that time, the UK was regarded as the sick man of Europe. It's remarkable how things keep coming around. I actually left the country and went to the United States and didn't come back for 20 years. I got a job first by, and they said, sure, we'll take you to the US. And I got a letter in those days, the personnel department, HR, was much more like the army than I think it is in modern day people management. So the letter read, Dear Browne, comma, your posting to Anchorage, Alaska is confirmed. This was not my idea of the United States at all, but what a great experience. And so I went and did field work as an engineer for a couple of years. And I actually learnt about the business by being put with the basics of the business, which was, you know, all business starts with someone doing something to create a product of some sort, whether it's software, hardware, a commodity, something, they create it. And the best thing I ever did was figure out that that's what happened, and you had to attend to that if you wanted to be in business, and you may as well learn about that early on. So I learned about that, and then I learned about becoming an engineer. Strangely, I wasn't an engineer, I was a physicist, so I had to go to night school, and that was another eye-opener. I went to the Anchorage Community College. I'd graduated very well at Cambridge University, and then I went to Anchorage Community College to take a conversion course from physics to engineering by night study. So I became an engineer, and I did that for 10 years, and that was the thing. I actually began to really understand how to solve real-world problems, and that's what I really wanted to do. I realized that if you take some expertise and create something that makes a difference to people in one way or another, then you were doing something important, productive, and probably valuable to an organization. And what really excited me was trying to solve problems that nobody else had solved before.
And then going to the big picture, obviously the industry and your thinking around the industry changed so much during your tenure. You were really the first leader in the space, you know, beyond petroleum, BP, your focus on fossil fuels and the future of fossil fuels. It's blindingly obvious to everybody today. It wasn't so obvious at that point in time. How did you get to that thinking?
Well, I gave a, I think many people in the industry know, I gave a speech in 97. I went back to one of my alma mater, Stanford University, and I gave a speech which basically said, the oil and gas industry is producing a lot of carbon dioxide and they are changing the climate and we have to do something about it. So I committed BP to a whole bunch of particularly measurable objectives that we would discharge. So the rest of the industry said, fine, you know, he's crazy and he's excommunicated. They said, he has left the church. So I didn't mind that too much because we'd spent a lot of time in BP trying to figure out the meaning of all this. There were a lot of very intelligent people who said, life is changing, the world is changing, and we had to assess whether or not they were talking nonsense or sense. And we concluded they were talking sense. Mm-hmm. And actually a lot of our staff, we remember an oil and gas company, certainly then, it was very high tech. We had hundreds, thousands of very highly qualified engineers and scientists, and they all had a view. So we asked for their view, and it was overwhelmingly, we must do something about it. So we started. And
how did you balance running an organization like that? Obviously, shareholder return and driving profitability, return on investment, absolutely critical. The rest of the industry would have excommunicated you because they said you can't make money by going this other path. We've got to stick to hydrocarbons, and that's where we make our money. How did you think through that balance?
Well, fortunately, the records show that we were making excess free cash flow. And we usually made more than the market actually thought we were going to make. And performance was improving the whole time. So the value of the firm rose hugely over that time. So we kind of got a buy. You know, people said, well, okay, you know, I suppose they can do some of that. And we balanced it with our basic R&D budget. So no one really minded, I suppose. I was fairly convinced that we were doing two things. One is we were trying to demonstrate that we deserved a seat at the table. So when things changed, we were part of the conversation. Mm. I think we achieved that. And secondly, we were there to see if one or other of these things could actually contribute to world energy. Mm. And it was so early that basically it was not profitable. But we thought it could be, and indeed it is today. Mm. I think, if I may, that was 97, and I think it was very important to BP, and it changed a lot of things, including the type of people who came to work for us. You know, so we began to draw in people who were different. They actually thought that, okay, well, energy is not about destroying the world. Mm. Energy is about giving people light, heat, and mobility, and we just got to fix how to do it. So if you come to today, I gave an interview to the FT 2 days ago about this. I'm absolutely convinced now that oil and gas companies have to be accountable for the carbon that's in their production, so-called scope 3, technical issue, but accountable for these things. And what's more, there is the technology to get rid of that carbon by capturing the carbon you produce either before it's burnt or after it's burnt through carbon capture and storage, or using the carbon dioxide. This can be done technically. Mm. It needs to be, either people need to be incentivized by a negative or positive incentive to get it done, taxes or subsidies, probably taxes, but they need to do this. Now, the other thing they've got to do, in my view, is figure out, so that solves the carbon business when it comes to produced hydrocarbons, which incidentally every forecast says we need them for 20, 30 years at the same level as today. So we've got to solve this problem. We can. And then I think every big company has a choice. Can they persuade people that excess cash flow could be reinvested for diversification? Mm. And that is the big challenge.
And so, and I think you maybe touched on this when you said 20, 30 years, but do you see a time when we are no longer using fossil fuels? Or do you think, you go back to the first part of your statement, you know, as long as we're capturing the carbon, as long as we're dealing with it, you know, they'll have a role to play for a very long time into the future?
Well, I'm a great believer in, you know, solving problems. Mm. So who knows in 30 years? Mm. I think I know about some things. You know, for example, if we could change the world's attitude to fission nuclear reactors we have today, we could solve a lot of this by building a lot of those. Don't know whether we'll get there. Fusion, you know, making it work like the sun, that's going to be a long time to get it commercial. I think probably the end of the century for that. So between the two, there might be something. But there's a lot of things, you know, we can still, What is extraordinary is, so here's an interesting point, I think. If you look at the amount of oil that goes into one unit of GDP in the world, since 1985, this has come down on a straight line and has been reduced so far by 33%. So this is amazing. We're actually becoming more and more efficient. So there's no, I don't understand why it should stop. It's a straight line, so probably carry on. I mean, obviously turn around eventually, but it should carry on. So gas, unfortunately, is flat, so maybe we'll get that coming down. So efficiency, new ideas, more carbon capture and storage. We need to do all these things. If we don't, then we've got quite a risk on our hands here. I mean, the temperature could rise, three, 4 degrees. Yeah. That's not good.
So let's turn to the book, which I've read, and I've got to say, I found it remarkably uplifting, positive, balanced, of course, and really the role of engineering and innovation in terms of really driving us forward, driving civilization forward. What motivated you to write this book? Why this one?
I think two things. First is I'm always surprised that people ignore engineering. When you talk about civilization to people, as I do, with all the things I do in the not-for-profit area, they'll talk about arts and humanities and plays and movies, and quite right too. They're very important things to stretch and enlighten the mind and educate people. But actually, they're all founded on one very simple and basic point, which is an engineering platform. Mm. That's what civilization's about. And I think people don't appreciate it, and when they look at it, very often they get scared. Mm. And I wanted to sort of reset the table a bit to say, this is very important. I'm not saying to you that engineering rules the world and forget everything else. That's naive. But I would say to you that you have to think about this, and it's really important because it will shape the future of the world as it has in the past, and look at what happened in the past, and it will shape the future, and you have to be part of that. And a lot of people want to check out. They don't actually want to recognize it.
Let's talk about the role of regulation in technology, because you can see the political discourse, and you see Zuckerberg in front of Congress, social media, privacy issues, robots putting people out of work. Yeah. How do you think about, speed of change, adaptation, role of regulation?
Well, it was one of the reasons I wrote the book, is to try and get people, if people could just sort of get up to speed a bit on what's really happening here and not overreact. For example, we've been worrying about the impact of automation on jobs for a very long time. Even when I was at Cambridge, I remember, this was a long time ago, going to meetings where they said, what are we going to do when computers come on desks and people have all this leisure time? I haven't seen this.
You see it here in this building, actually, all these computers.
It does actually have a turnout, that. Compared with 120 years ago, the work week's dropped by 50%. So we're down to, on average, and I do stress on average, I know that here we're in the top 1%, on average it's 36 hours a week. But there's no reason why that can't drop again. And obviously social policy has to change because we can need different hourly wages, but actually we probably do need more people to do the one thing that machines will never do, which is to give people empathy. We need more people in empathy. As well as what I realized when you go to one of the companies I used to be involved with, Mercedes, and I still go there, is to see what happens in a factory now. In the olden days, you had these huge robots that were in cages that were scary and you couldn't go anywhere close to them, and they metal bashed, basically. Now you have robots which work with humans and they provide a menu of parts and they work together, very sort of gentle approach. So it's not wholly clear what actually happens to employment, except for the fact chances are you need to be better educated to get a job, which is a statement of the obvious. So I think a lot of these things can be diffused, but they're certainly very scary. So I think there's one thing about change. And certainly, I think change is never as fast as we think it is. I notice with, in particular, you know, being inundated with lots of venture capital proposals is, you know, how people are amazingly naive on timescales. It just takes longer. And, you know, we've still been waiting, for example, for electric cars were going to be the thing 30 years ago. You know, I mean, there are a few. It just takes time, and there will be more, but it takes time. So that's the time scales, I think, is one thing.
Maybe two slightly political questions. You know, one, inequality, you talked about you may need to be better educated. What does all of the say for that? And then secondly, the geographic, you know, the US has one approach to this, Europe has a different one.
China
Russia maybe has a third. But let's start with inequality and then talk about the geographic balance and the impact that that'll have on growth in those different territories.
So, well, first, everyone here I'm sure knows the data that, you know, when it comes to returns, returns went to capital, not labor. And it, boy, has it changed. So we're back to the same ratio of inequality as we had in 1920 today, because all the returns went to capital. So that probably is cyclical. I can't believe it'll carry on. Something will happen. Social policy will adapt. But equally, social policy has to, as it has done, it's continued to adapt over history, and I see no reason why it won't. So the laws change, social policy, regulation changes. And that's the point about regulation. I think so it all keeps changing, and it should do. What it can't do, and this is where regulation has got a problem, is it can't keep track of things very often until it sees something going wrong. You notice a lot of regulation is kind of fixing a problem rather than preventing a problem. And so I think that's where people get very annoyed, you know. So Facebook has to do something bad in order for people to say, well, maybe we should start regulating this, you know, or, you know, you have, you know, one accident with an autonomous vehicle, and people say, we need new laws for autonomous vehicles. The mere fact that they're probably 40,000 times safer than human drivers is neither here nor there, because I think we probably expect them to be 100,000 times safer. So there's a lot of, you know, contradiction here, but regulation is important, partly because it stops people taking a free ride. I mean, in business, I like regulation because I don't like people taking a free ride on me if I'm going to make something safer or better for the public.
And let's talk about the US, Europe, China, different approaches.
All very different. And all very different, and the big issue is the transition. We know very well that in the long run, all this stuff sorts out. The big question is the transition. So in Europe, I think people are trying to soft land the transition. They're not succeeding. Look at the regional policy in the UK, for example, where they might have attended to London, but go to Leeds, it's a different matter. In China, it's all about managed activity of the population and managed activity of the educational system, which looks okay, except it certainly, and it's fine if you don't believe that people should have free choice, because they don't. And so there's a mix, I think, between these two extremes. The US has had this rather direct approach and has resulted in a more populist administration. You know, everything has a consequence. But I don't think you can't put the steel industry back together again. You certainly can't put coal mining together again. Nobody wants the coal, actually, in spite of how cheap it is in some cases, but it's not cheap in the US. So you can't reconstruct things. You have to think about how do you redeploy or how do you change what a community can do. And communities will come and go. They will die. They do die. You just have to look at some of the ancient communities, and you know that they do die on a continuous basis.
And the world keeps moving on.
The world keeps moving on.
Just staying with politics, you're a member of the House of Lords, obviously. You've been in and around policymakers for a very, very long time. Has it always been thus as in the state we're in now? One question. And secondly, so much of this book is about thinking big plans, moving things forward. Do we have the political capacity in our systems now to make the decisions? Everything seems to be so fraught.
My view is, as a general rule, you should expect politics to be irrational and very occasional. In other words, it's more about the announcement than it is the execution. It's about the short term than the long term. And you should also think of it as local, not global. Mm. Once in a while, all that changes. And once in a while, someone comes up with a big idea that gets through, and it's really worth pushing to get to that point. But it's not often. And once in a while, we come up with a good idea globally, globalization, like trade. Well, we don't like it anymore. Yeah. So we're changing it, and who knows, we may get back to where we started.
Going to the moon.
It's all these sorts of things, but I don't want to sound flippant, but you cannot expect any politician, I think, to take into account the interests of everybody except beyond their constituency, whatever their constituency it is, whether it's the Chinese Communist Party or whether it's an MP Hill or a representative in the United States, it's all local. Mm.
Maybe just one final question. There's so many examples of engineering practically solving problems in this book. If you had to look back over history, which is the most impressive
technological? Can I pick two very simple ones?
You can pick two,
So I think, first of all, I do think the hand axe was one of the extraordinary breakthroughs. To take a naturally shaped stone and to enhance it in order to cut up an animal and change completely the diet and therefore the evolution of the human. That was an amazing thing. And the other thing, which I talk about in the book, which is a very simple thing, was the stirrup. The stirrup was the start of real engineered transportation. You could actually have more people ride a horse and control the horse than you could with bareback and all that sort of stuff. So the stirrup was the breakthrough that made it possible to change the face of the world, which is what it did.
Two fantastic examples. John, thank you very, very much.
Thank you.